Good morning and welcome to worship at First Congregational Church. We are so very pleased to see you, and I just want to give a shout out to Lorene this morning for that beautiful music. Amen is right. Thank you, Lorene. I always have to remind myself, okay, time to get up now. You're just listening. You need to move. But again, thank you for joining us. Wow, what a pleasant awareness of the green happening around us this morning with all the rain and the blessing of spring hopefully settling in. I know we're going to have a little backtrack on that here, but it is a blessing that we have that spring to look forward to. Just a reminder that the offering plates are located in the narthex. We do not pass the offering plate during the service, but those will be brought forward to be placed on the altar during our service. Also, spring items made by our crafters are available for a donation downstairs in Fellowship Hall. We are collecting goods for Fighting Hunger in Newaygo County. Please consider donating packaged and canned food items to the True North Food Pantry. We have a basket in the narthex, and your contributions are greatly appreciated. Please join us next Sunday after worship, Fellowship Hall, for a brunch hosted by the Women's Fellowship. The menu will be breakfast casserole with hash browns, ham, and a fruit cup. Please do sign up today. Sign up sheet downstairs in Fellowship Hall. The ladies do need to have an idea of how many people will be able to join that brunch next Sunday. So if you could please sign up today, that would be awesome. Also, please mark your calendar for a make and take summer flower pot arrangement to be held Saturday, May 20th, 10 a.m. in Fellowship Hall. Please also sign up for that in the coffee counter in Fellowship Hall. So again, the Women's Fellowship, and they have a number about getting supplies for that. Just a couple of requested announcements coming to the Fremont United Methodist Church on Saturday, April 29th at 5 p.m. Brent Vernon, singer, songwriter, ventriloquist, author, illustrator. I understand he's a great performer. Some more information in your bulletin about that, but that's April 29th. Also, the spring concert by the River Country Community Choir this year will be at the Dogwood Center on Sunday, May 21st at 3 p.m. Just a note that I believe we're still expecting our new media equipment this week to be installed. There'll be a training next Saturday for that for the IT folks. Shout out to the IT folks for that. Thank you. You guys are awesome back there, by the way. See, because now they're directing me to not forget this. So also on the 29th of April, donation drive here at our church for Love, Inc. So if you have some gently used items that would be great for the cause of Love, Inc., please consider bringing them to that drop-off between 9 and 3, I believe. Yes, 9 and 3 on the 29th. And thank you to the Men's Fellowship for donating your time to get that going, and Jeff for spearheading that. And again, the 29th. I am hoping to see you there myself that day. I hope you have many blessings today. Thank you again for joining us.
Well, good morning, everyone. I was preparing to say welcome. Thank you for joining us on this beautiful sunny morning, because as I was up, the sun was coming up and it looked great. And then I get out to jump in the car and suddenly it's raining. So suddenly it changed from, oh, this beautiful sunny day, maybe I'll go garden, to maybe I'll put on some jazz and sit by a window and wistfully, I don't know, whatever you do when you're wistfully sitting by a window, you know, read a book or write poetry or something. But it's so wonderful to see you all. Thank you for coming today. Thank you for joining us to celebrate the resurrection of Jesus, because it is still Easter season. I want to take a particular moment to thank everyone who helped over the weekend. You don't know, because so many people put time and effort in, but we had a wedding here yesterday, and it was apparently quite a big one. So a lot of people put time and effort to help that all go through and then make sure the church looks as wonderful as it does. So I want to thank like Bernie, Angela, who is our, helps clean up the church. So if you ever see her around, thank her. She does a wonderful job. Leslie, Dean, and I'm sure I'm forgetting someone else, but oh, Jim. Jim came in and set up the altar again, and Bill was here. We had a lot of people come in, make sure the building was ready for us today. So I want to thank them for that. Running a church is not an easy thing. It's a communal effort. Lots of people put time in, and often it's not seen. So I want to make sure we thank everybody who put time and effort in and who it gives of them, of their skills and all of that. So thank you so much for all of that. With that, let us go into our call to worship, which comes from Psalm 16. Protect me, O God, for in you I take refuge. I say to the Lord, you are my Lord. I have no good apart from you. The Lord is my chosen portion and my cup. You hold my lot. The boundary lines have fallen for me in pleasant places. I have a goodly heritage. I bless the Lord who gives me counsel. In the night also my heart instructs me. I keep the Lord always before me. Because he is at my right hand, I shall not be moved. Therefore, my heart is glad and my soul rejoices. My body also rests secure. For you did not give me up to Sheol or let your faithful one see the pit. You show me the path of life. In your presence, there is fullness of joy. In your right hand are pleasures forevermore. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, I thank you for gathering us today to worship the risen King, your Son, Jesus Christ, who rose from the dead on that Easter morning. That event continues to resonate for us. We continue to wonder at what happened there. Thank you for helping us raise from our own power of sin and death that had over us, Lord. I pray that this is a time of rejoicing and of growth of hope, Lord. Let this service be a time when your glory is declared by all of us, Lord. And I pray that it also transforms us into the image that you have for us. Help us to be a people who cry, my Lord and my God. I pray all of this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Morning. It's now is the time for all good Christians. This is the best time of our Christian year to get up and sing loud and sing well. So our opening hymn is Worship Christ the Risen King. It's based on Mark's 16 verses 6. He is risen, he is not here. So it's hymn number 361, Worship Christ the Risen King. Please stand. Verses 1, 2, and 3.
Rise, O church, and lift your voices. Christ has conquered death and hell. Sing as all the earth rejoices, resurrection anthem swell. Come and worship, come and worship. Worship Christ the risen King. Hear the earth protest and tremble. See the stone removed with power. All hell's minions may assemble, but cannot withstand his hour. He has conquered. He has conquered Christ the Lord, the risen King. We acclaim your life, O Jesus. Now we sing your victory. Sin and hell may seek to seize us, but your conquest keeps us free. Stand in triumph, stand in triumph, worship Christ the risen King.
The resurrection is the greatest event in all of history. There's no wonder that we can be a joyous people when we know that that has happened. And yet, We look at the resurrection and cannot forget why it had to happen. Because we are a fallen people, and we sin. And yet the glory of the resurrection is that sinful people receive forgiveness. And so we join together to confess our sins and receive that wonderful mercy and pardon that God so freely gives to all of us. So let us take a moment to silently reflect on this week and to bring to mind those things we need to ask our Heavenly Father to forgive us of. Lord, bring new life where we are worn and tired. New love where we have turned hard-hearted. Forgiveness where we feel hurt and where we have wounded. The joy and freedom of your Holy Spirit where we are prisoners of ourselves. Amen. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, who in his great mercies has promised forgiveness of sins to all those who sincerely repent and with true faith turn to him, have mercy upon you. Pardon and deliver you from all your sins. Confirm and strengthen you in all goodness and bring you to everlasting life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. To all and to each on his community and on his friends, where regret is real, Jesus pronounces his pardon and grants us the right to begin again. Thanks be to God. Please stand for our response, the Gloria Patri.
Good morning. The first reading this morning is from Acts, the second chapter, verse 14 and verses 22 through 32. Then Peter stood up with the 11, raised his voice, and addressed the crowd. Fellow Jews and all of you who live in Jerusalem, let me explain this to you. Listen carefully to what I say. Fellow Israelites, listen to this. Jesus of Nazareth was a man accredited by God to you by miracles, wonders, and signs, which God did among you through him, as you yourself know. This man was handed over to you by God's deliberate plan and foreknowledge, and you, with the help of wicked men, put him to death by nailing him to the cross. But God raised him from the dead, freeing him from the agony of death, because it was impossible for death to keep its hold on him. David said about him, I saw the Lord always before me, because he is at my right hand. I will not be shaken. Therefore, my heart is glad and my tongue rejoices. My body also will rest in hope, because you will not abandon me to the realm of the dead. You will not let your Holy One see decay. You have made known to me the paths of life. You will fill me with joy in your presence. Fellow Israelites, I can tell you confidently that the patriarch David died and was buried, and his tomb is here to this day. But he was a prophet and knew that God had promised him an oath that he would place one of his descendants on his throne. Seeing what was to come, he spoke of the resurrection of the Messiah, that he was not abandoned to the realm of the dead, nor did his body see decay. God has raised this Jesus to life, and we are all witnesses of it. The second reading is from 1 Peter, the first chapter, verses 2-9, who have been chosen according to the foreknowledge of God the Father, through the sanctifying work of the Spirit, to be obedient to Jesus Christ and sprinkled with his blood, grace and peace be yours in abundance. Praise be to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. In his great mercy, he has given us new birth into a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, and into an inheritance that can never perish, spoil, or fade. This inheritance is kept in heaven for you, who through faith are shielded by God's power until the coming of the salvation that is ready to be revealed in the last time. In all this you greatly rejoice, though now for a little while you may have had to suffer grief in all kinds of trials. These have come so that the proven genuineness of your faith, of greater worth than gold, which perishes even though refined by fire, may result in praise, glory, and honor when Jesus Christ is revealed. Though you have not seen him, you love him. And even though you do not see him now, you believe in him and are filled with an inexpressible and glorious joy, for you are receiving the end result of your faith, the salvation of your souls. The last reading is the Gospel of John, chapter 20, verses 19-31. On the evening of that first day of the week, when the disciples were together with the doors locked for fear of the Jewish leaders, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." And after he said this, he showed them his hands and side. The disciples were overjoyed when they saw the Lord. Again, Jesus said, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, I am sending you." And with that, he breathed on them and said, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive anyone's sins, their sins are forgiven. If you do not forgive them, they are not forgiven." Now Thomas, also known as Didymus, was one of the 12, was not with the disciples when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, "We have seen the Lord." But he said to them, "Unless I see the nail marks in his hands, and put my finger where the nails were, and put my hand into his side, I will not believe." A week later, his disciples were in the house again, and Thomas was with them. Though the doors were locked, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." Then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here. See my hands? Reach out your hand and put it into my side. Stop doubting and believe." Thomas said to him, "My Lord and my God." Then Jesus told him, "Because you have seen me, you have believed. Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have believed." Jesus performed many other signs in the presence of his disciples, which are not recorded in this book. But these are written that you may believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and that by believing you may have life in his name. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
For the next few weeks, till Pentecost, in fact, we'll be exploring what it means to be a resurrection people, what it means to live in light of the resurrection. You see, Easter isn't just one day, but the season of Easter goes on for, if I remember correctly, 50 days, because it's such a great event, we just can't celebrate it for one Sunday. But it keeps going on and on. The joy never ends. In fact, every Sunday in and of itself is an Easter celebration. It's the reason why we meet on Sunday morning, because that's the morning Jesus rose. So this Easter season, that is what we're going to be looking at. What does it mean to live in light of the resurrection? How do we live, and what does it mean now that everything has changed? How does it change us? So during this season, we'll be looking at a lot of readings from the book of Acts and 1 Peter, which are books that deal quite a bit with what it means to be a resurrection people, which is why today I'm taking my passage from our 1 Peter reading. It's written by the Apostle Peter, as you might get from, you know, verse 1, which says, Peter, an apostle of Jesus Christ. And he's writing to, as best as we can tell, the Jewish Christians who live outside of Palestine, the Jewish Christians in the Diaspora, spread throughout the Roman world. And Peter is writing to encourage them. As best we can tell, the Christians he was writing to were experiencing some sort of persecution. We're not really sure what it is. Probably something local to the area, or it could just be simply them being persecuted in the sense that they're dealing with the effects of maybe being pushed out of the synagogue, or, you know, the loss of business connections, whatever it is. There seems to be some sort of persecution going on, and Peter is writing to encourage them and how to live in light of what Christ has done and what it means to be an Easter people, a people with a living hope, and a people who should be known by their hope and joy. He begins by reminding them of who they are. That's where we come in at verse 3. Because if you think about it, it is surprisingly easy to forget what your real identity is. That's why Peter starts there, because he wants to set the foundation, the absolute basic idea of what is going on. Because we often take on the view of others. We often see ourselves how the world sees ourselves. We see how they think and talk about us, and then we take that on as our identity. Part of this is very natural. You know, as a child, you have this connection with your parents, and they love you, and it helps you. I develop this identity. I am my parents' child. Unfortunately, sometimes that continues on, or maybe not unfortunately, because we are communal creatures. But sometimes that goes on and becomes a negative thing. We forget which community we are defined by. Instead of being defined by our place in the kingdom of heaven, we're defined by what people think we are in the kingdom of this world. So we're defined by those around us, judged by some standard they choose. We can all think of how, even if we're honest, how we judge others. Maybe people are judged on their wealth, or their looks, or their ethnicity, or their family history, or their job, or whether or not they have some arbitrary thing that makes them a little bit different, or whatever. We are often judged, and truthfully, we often judge for who, what, or why we are what we are, or why we are not what we are, or who or what, and so forth. We see this all the time. It's why it seems that all our politicians have to have a nice hair and surprisingly white teeth, because Lord knows you can't have an average-looking person as our president, because, you know, good looks are clearly what it takes to be a good leader. We see this all the time with height. For some reason, tall people are more likely to get hired, because we are judged by these arbitrary things in our world. Sometimes this definer can be a good person, a loving parent or coach who's telling us, you got to work hard, you can do it, I believe in you, you can be whatever you want to be, and we take on this identity. That may not be wrong, but may not be us. You know, the person whose parent pushed them said, you can do anything. You should be a lawyer and be successful and so on and so forth. And the person gets through law school and discovers that, wait a second, I did this because I wanted to please my parent, not because I have any interest in the law or whatever the job could be. There's the classic midlife crisis where a person suddenly realizes, like, wait a second, is this at all what I want? Or am I just doing stuff because that's what people expected? I went to college and I got a job and I got a mortgage and I got a car, and suddenly you realize, wait a sec, I didn't want any of this. I wanted to be, I don't know, it's always, I wanted to be a poet living in the UP, you know, or something silly like that. But they're defined, even by loving things, or, as often happens, by some cruel bully from school, or someone who is harsh, or maybe it's the critic in your head, you know, screaming at you that you're not good enough, or you're a failure, or whatever. We find ourselves defined by people outside of us, by those surrounding us, and we see ourselves in that way. Oh, I'm not achieving whatever it is in this world I'm supposed to be. I'm not looking the way I'm supposed to. And we forget that our true identity comes from Christ. And that's important because it affects how we approach everything. I was reading this weekend and I was reminded of this wonderful ritual that there was for the Habsburg emperors. Now, that's not something in our history we as Americans we usually know about, but it was in many ways one of the greatest empires that was ever there. The Habsburg Empire, they were the ruled this huge diverse land for nearly 1,000 years, this one family. And they had this wonderful ritual they did when the emperor died, you know, the most powerful person in that part of the world. And so there'd be this huge procession, and they'd walk up to this monastery, and then the guy leading it would knock on the door 3 times, and a monk would poke his head out and says, "Who's there?" And this important official would read off a list of all the emperor's names and achievements. And you know, it would take 15, 20 minutes. If you've ever seen the full name of any European noble, you know it's long. And he'd read off all the great things, the defeater of this, the king of this, the guy who's just so swell. And the monk would look around, slam the door and say, "I don't know him." Most important person in the world in many ways. Most powerful. The guy would knock again 3 times and the monk would open it and ask, "Who's there?" And the official would read off the whole list again. The monk would look at him, say, "Don't know him, don't care," slam the door. Finally, they'd knock 1 more time. And the monk would poke his head out and say, "Who's there?" And the official would say, "A mortal man and a sinner." And the monk would say, "Come on in." Because whatever it is we attach to ourselves, whatever great things or terrible things, because it can go either way, that our identity accumulates as we go through life, what ultimately matters is our identity in Christ and who we are through his resurrection. That's why it's talked of as the new birth, because all of that is washed away. All the bad, and if you're proud of all your titles and achievements, all the good. We stand before Christ as new children. All of it washed away, because none of that ultimately matters. That is all outside of the important thing. The old things pass away as we go through new birth. Peter was writing to people who were forgetting this fact that they are children of God who have a living hope because they were facing suffering. It's not unusual when we're facing some great event, good or bad, that we forget it. When we're on top of the world, we're the success, we're the bee's knees, we got money to spend. We've achieved whatever it is we want to achieve. We forget. We think, oh, because I've gotten this job, or I've done this, or I've, whatever that silly thing is, we think we're super important until it quickly fades away. Or the reverse. We're going through some terrible situation, some suffering, as Peter talks about. We can forget that suffering takes over our identity. But as children of God who are loved and saved by grace, we can walk through life with joy. That's what Peter is declaring. That's what he's reminding them. Don't forget who you are, because that affects how you face these difficulties. As resurrection people, we go through life in a different way. It is not how others face life. And as anybody here who's gone through anything that would even be close to suffering, we might ask Peter, well, why? Why is it any different? Don't you know, Peter? I mean, Peter, it's not always been easy for you. Don't you know how terrible whatever it is? And Peter says, it's not because we will not face hardships. Peter doesn't pull any punches at all. It's one of the beautiful things about Peter throughout the whole New Testament. He doesn't pull punches. He says, I get it. Being a Christian does not mean we won't face hardships. In fact, Peter says, you rejoice even if you've had to suffer various trials. Some seem to think that being a Christian means not having to suffer. Oh, if you pray enough, if you're a good enough Christian, you're just going to get all sorts of blessings. All sorts of good things are going to happen to you. I'm going to pick on him because he can handle it. But I was watching this video. I don't even know how it came across my screen, of Steve Harvey. And apparently he wanted to buy his wife some special car. Some fancy car, because that's, you know, it's her birthday. And the car did not exist. The model and color that he wanted was no longer there. And he said, well, you'll call me and let me know. And 2 weeks before, he got the call. And he said, you know why I got that car? Because I believe in a God who likes to bless. And, you know, I'm happy for Steve and for his wife. And she got whatever fancy car it was. But I'm sorry, that's not how it works. God doesn't just bestow fancy cars on us because he likes us. Nowhere in the Bible says if you pray and you're a good Christian and you tithe, you're going to get all your dreams fulfilled. This isn't about avoiding suffering. Our faith is not about making life easier. God isn't our rich buddy who likes to cover our meals because he can. And nowhere in the Bible do we find a promise that will avoid all of life's hardships. Rather, as Peter calls us to, we're called to pick up our cross. Now, we often think of the cross as that cute little trinket we wear around our neck or we see at the back of the church, but the cross is a pretty awful torture device. There are very few worse ways to die than being crucified on a cross. It was designed to be as inhumane as possible. This was the Romans' way of saying, don't mess with us because we will do this to you. And people are like, yeah, man, nope, don't want anything to do with that. So the difference between a believer, a resurrection person, a person living in light of Easter, and the non-believer, the materialist, isn't the amount of suffering we face. Life is hard. Life is full of suffering. Even the person with the most easiest life, the one with the silver spoon, who's got it all, everything comes to them. They got good looks, they got talent, they were raised with loving parents who had lots of money, and they got into the right college and got the right job. Even that mythical person will face difficulties and suffering, and it will be hard. In fact, if there's any difference between the Christian and the other side when it comes to suffering, it's that the Christian probably will suffer more. Because we resist the flow of this world. We don't suffer, we don't follow the king who had it easy. If you look at the life of Jesus, it's not the easy life. No one wants to be the homeless guy who has to sleep on the side of the road and makes all the authorities really mad by what you say. That's who Jesus is. Rather, the difference between the believer, the one living in light of Easter, the one living in light of the resurrection, is how we face the suffering that comes. When I read this passage, it struck me that you could probably argue there at, broadly speaking, and if you let me stretch the term a little bit, three kinds of suffering we're going to face. The first kind is the kind Peter was very likely addressing in this epistle. It's speaking of the persecution of Christians. Rome did not like people serving any king but Caesar. They really did not like it. They had a little ritual that all their citizens had to do. They'd go into the marketplace, take a little pinch of incense, and they'd burn it in front of a pitcher of Caesar, because Caesar is a god. That's what was going there. And they didn't actually care whether you believed it or not. The point was for you to go and do it. And so they did not like it when the Christians would declare, I cannot burn that incense to Caesar because Caesar is not Lord. Jesus is Lord. That made them mad. They didn't actually care who you worshiped. They just wanted you to make sure that in your actual physical daily life, you know who Lord is. And if you think about it, the statement Jesus is Lord is an incredibly radical statement. Think about it for a moment. What does it mean in our life if Jesus is truly Lord above all, including Lord above our desires and our wants? It means that there might be things that, even things we like, that we might not have, we might give up because our Lord tells us to follow a different path. And so throughout history, Christians have suffered for their faith because they say, in the face of kings and powers and rulers, I'm sorry, I will do what you command as long as it does not cross with the statement, Jesus is Lord. That's what we're told to do. Honor those who are put in authority over you up until they tell you, stop following your faith. And so, persecution comes. Rejecting whatever regime or culture it is to serve King Jesus is a dangerous business. Now, all that to say, as modern Americans, we're pretty lucky. We don't really have to worry about this much. Every now and again, you'll see some person on Twitter saying, oh, Christians are persecuted. And, you know, maybe, I don't know, you'll lose a little status or something. But when you look around the world, we got it really good. Just look at Nicaragua, where they're pulling off leaders off the street. The Catholic bishop of Nicaragua was just arrested and put it in jail. There's places in Africa where going to church means not just being like targeted and ostracized. It means you're facing the chance that going, you will not come back home because somebody might come in and blow the place up. All over the world, there's real persecution. We should pray for those who face it. The second type of suffering is the suffering we all face, all people, all humanity in all times, the suffering of life, the illness, the struggles, the hurt we all face, that stuff that was talked about in Genesis. You know, life gets hard after the introduction of sin. Hurt by friends and family, by failures to not achieve our hopes and dreams, sickness, injury, the effects of aging, death, the stress of everyday life. This is also part of the suffering that we face. All the stuff that comes with living in a sinful world. Like I said, we're not promised freedom from the hard stuff of life. We're not free from the stress that comes with just living. So this is another suffering we go through. The final kind of suffering I would argue that is in view here, at least broadly speaking, is the suffering that comes from living a Christian life, from striving for holiness. And I use suffering lightly here because it's very different than the suffering you experience when you, say, break your leg or, you know, a friend betrays you. But it's the suffering that comes from practicing our faith, from trying to reach that level of holiness God calls us to. To do anything well, it takes intentional practice. Ask any athlete, or think of any of the greatest athletes you can think of, and they shape their whole life around their sport. How they sleep, how they eat, how they exercise, how they practice, everything goes around it. And it can become incredibly tedious. I remember watching a video on bodybuilders, and it's amazing what these people go through for that sport. They'll eat like 14 meals, and every one is dry chicken and rice. And they'll spend hours on a bike just slowly moving. They got to burn just enough calories. And then the days before, they'll go without water so their muscles look as big as possible, all to win a medal. Or there's that wonderful story. I believe it's Kobe Bryant. There was another player who's like, oh, I know Kobe Bryant. He's always out there a couple hours before the game practicing. So I'm going to do that because he's the greatest or one of the greatest. And he goes out there and it turns into this competition where they're just out there shooting baskets over and over and running drills again and again and again because they wanted to be the best. And when you spend your whole life as a basketball player, it gets tedious this third hour of the day that you're practicing drills. And this is true for all fields, from artists to scientists to business people, whatever it is. People who seek to excel have to put up with this quote-unquote suffering because they shape their lives. They give up on things to achieve their goal. Excellence takes cultivation. And this is true of the whole of living a holy life as well. It takes suffering, giving up those things that our sinful heart desires. We need to say no to things that we want. We may give up pursuing something that would give us fame or power or money because God's calling us to do something else. Maybe you could think of somebody who's called to the medical field and they want to be some rich and famous surgeon in New York and, you know, get all the money and power and accolades. But God says, no, I want you to go to one of the poorest parts of the country and be a general doctor. Maybe they're called to the UP or the Appalachian Mountains or, you know, the Apache Indian Reservation out west, a place where there ain't going to be no money. No one's going to come around and slap them on the back and say, boy, you made good life choices. Living a holy life means giving things up. It means maybe being willing to lose friends who call us to do things we know we're not supposed to do, or refusing to do things that will make our lives easier. It's so easy to say that white lie. Just let it go. Maybe, you know, if we're a business owner, just cut back a little bit. You know, they'll never know that I didn't use quite as much equipment, or I bought slightly not as good stuff, or I charged them an hour, but I only gave them a half an hour, or whatever it is. We cut back. We don't clean as well as we should. The call to give to the poor and the needy, to dedicate time that we'd rather spend watching TV to studying the Bible and prayer and fasting. Well, these aren't the sufferings of watching a loved one suffer through illness. It is still the suffering of exercise, of trying to live up to what we're called for. It's not easy. It's uncomfortable. It's something we'd rather avoid, much like Exercise, something I know a lot about, avoiding exercise. But to achieve that goal of holiness, that goal we're called to, we're going to have to suffer because we're going to be going against what our desires are. And here's the key point. All that suffering, and even the ones I haven't hit today, we can face these trials with joy and hope. Peter tells us this because they are no longer meaningless. If we don't have the hope of resurrection, suffering becomes this thing, this empty thing that just happens. What do we do when we're sick? It's just meaningless because there's no meaning at all. It's an empty world that just goes. And so the bad things are just something that happens you got to live through. But we can face it with joy because we know there's something more. Nothing in the world is meaningless. The wonder of God's mercy makes it easier for us to face the difficulties in life. We can face our sufferings with faith and hope and joy because we know that by doing so, it brings honor and glory to our King. People see us walking through the difficulties of life and still being hopeful and joyful and radiating life. And they ask, what's up with you, weirdo? I went through something like that, and boy, I was a miserable, no good so-and-so. Why aren't you that way? We say, because we know something you don't know. We have a living hope, something that keeps us going even when we don't want to. God doesn't make us suffer just to boost his ego. He doesn't say, oh, I'm going to give Gary a hard time so my glory gets increased. That's not how this works. Even though us going through difficulties does bring him glory. Suffering is the result of humanity turning from God in the grand scheme. But as we face our sufferings and preserve, we can do so because we know the end result of the life of Christian. We know that when this all wraps up, we have salvation. We have joy because our lives are pointed to and connected to something greater. God. And as others must face suffering in the world stripped from meaning, we face it as something that allows us to draw closer to our Heavenly Father. I go through my sufferings and radiate joy because I know I'm loved. Because I know in the end where I will end up. For the materialist, life is maybe a little bit of fun, then suffering, then nothing. There's nothing else. Close your eyes the last time and it's gone. That's what they believe. And so suffering just becomes this terrible thing that maybe they grit through with their teeth. But for the Christian, it's completely different. Yes, there's suffering for the Christian, but now they can face it with hope and joy. Because as they walk through it, they know in the end there is eternal life in heaven. We can face anything. There's nothing that we can't suffer through because we know where it comes in the end. Jesus is our living hope, the resurrected King, the promise that all things will be made right. And in the face of eternity, the sufferings we face now become just a moment, a breath. And as his followers, we've received the benefits of that resurrection. We are a people with living hope because we know the living hope. And just as he rose from the dead, so will we. And so we can face our sufferings with hope and joy. And by doing so, point to the glorious Easter King we all love and serve. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, I thank you for the encouragement that your disciple Peter writes to us. That even as we walk through difficult trials, through the valley of the shadow of death, we can still have joy. We often forget it, Lord, but we pray that you bring it to mind, that you remind us who and what we are, and that, yes, even though we suffer it with you, and that you can bring us hope and perseverance and even joy in the face of the darkest things, because we know how it all ends. It ends with us, with you, for all eternity. Thank you for that wonderful promise that carries us through. I pray that this is never far from our mind, no matter what we go through. I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Let us stand and recite the Apostles' Creed in response to the wonderful news that we have heard today. I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Okay, we're going to stay standing, and our hymn is He Lives. It's number 368. This is absolutely my favorite hymn. To me, it's like the World Series of all World Series hymns, or the Super Bowl of all Super Bowls. So let's sing it like it's a Super Bowl. 368, all three verses. I serve a risen Savior in the world today. I know that he is living, whatever man may say. I see his hand of mercy, I hear his voice of cheer, and just the time I need him, he's always near. He lives, as Jesus lives today. He walks with me and talks with me along life's narrow way. He lives, he lives, salvation to heart. You ask me how I know he lives within my heart. In all the world around me, I see his loving care, and though my heart grows weary, will despair, I know that he is leading through all the stormy blast. The day of his appearing will come at last. He lives, Christ Jesus lives today. He walks with me and talks with me along the narrow way. He lives, salvation to impart. You ask me how I know he lives within my heart. Rejoice, rejoice, O Christian, lift up your voice and sing eternal hallelujah to Jesus Christ the King, the hope of all who seek him, of all who find. None other is so loving, so good and kind. He lives,
Jesus lives today. He walks with me and talks with me along life's narrow way. He lives, he lives, patient to impart. You ask me how I know he lives. He lives my heart.
Well, let us go to the Lord in prayer. Heavenly Father, I thank you for your love, for your care, that you sent your Son to die on the cross so that we may have life, but not just life, but have good life, that we may have joy through the suffering, but also that we know that when we suffer, you will respond to us, that you will be there with us in those moments. Lord, we lift up the family of Bruce Smith who passed away unexpectedly, Lord. Be with them, Lord. Give them strength and support in this time. Let them know that you love them. Lord, we thank you that Carrie was able to wake up this morning and get up with no pain. Thank you for the miracle of modern medicine. Thank you for the love he's felt through this time. Lord, thank you for that. Lord, we also lift up Deb and Matt as they continue to go through this situation. We pray for strength for them as they face what is coming, Lord. We pray that you are with them, that they never feel you far away. Lord, we lift up all those who are suffering in the world, Lord. Those who are suffering here today who didn't want to bring it up, Lord. We pray that your strength is with them, Lord. We thank you that we can lean on you through all our sufferings. Lord, we want to lift up those who are in leadership over us, Lord. We lift up the president and the governor and our representatives and our mayor, Lord. Be with them. Give them wisdom and guidance, Lord, as they go about their work. You have established them, Lord, so guide them and direct them and help them to lead with wisdom. Lord, we pray for a blessing on the community of Fremont, Lord. We pray for prosperity and peace, that this is a place where your blessings are known. Lord, I pray for all of us here. Help us to be witnesses of your grace, Lord, that wherever we go, people are drawn to you, that they hear from us that there is a good and loving God who is there for them. We pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen. Let us pray the Lord's Prayer together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Please stand for the doxology. Heavenly Father, we dedicate these gifts to you, these small tokens of our worship, of our little ways of declaring that you are our Lord and our God. And we pray that you use these and do something wonderful to build your kingdom so that your word may be preached and that more people may hear of the wonder of Easter and that they may also live that resurrection life. We pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen.
This is from, it's from John. It's, because I live, you also live. So the name of it's Because He Lives, it's 368, and we're going to sing all three verses.
I am the resurrection and the life, says the Lord. May Christ's rising lift your spirits and gladden your hearts. Alleluia. Amen. The peace of Christ be with you. Go and tell the world that you have found a living hope, and they can too. Amen.